the San Francisco Bay Area on a gorgeous evening for college football. And a laid-back California crowd begins the stroll up the hill to Strawberry Canyon. Oregon's in town. It's the Bears and the Ducks. And for Berkeley, it's a very big deal. They have their own way of doing things, their own style, their own path. It's through the air most of the time, and at all times, it's fast. Football in the West, free-spirited, full of color, excitement, and fun. Like a view of the Pacific coastline, it'll take your breath away. So take a deep gulp of rich October oxygen. Tonight, the California Golden Bears and the Oregon Ducks air it out in prime time, Pac-10 style, on Saturday Night Football. You are looking live at California's Memorial Stadium. It's the kind of evening sprinters love to strut their stuff. Let the scoreboard lights start to dance, folks, Pac-10 style, as we welcome you to Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines. Here at California Memorial Stadium, it's the number 11 Oregon Ducks and the number 16 California Golden Bears. A very good evening and a welcome to everybody. I'm Brett Musburger, along with the coach, Bob Davey. Now, Kirk Herbstreit is with the gang down in Gainesville. We'll be hearing from them shortly. But you know, Bob, we're going to be talking about a 60-point evening here tonight.
Brent, I think you might be right. You know, when people around the country think about Pac-10 football, they think about explosive offenses and a lot of points. I think tonight's game is going to confirm those thoughts. Both these offenses have a different style, but they have one thing in common. They both score a lot of points. Oregon averages 40 points a game. They run the true spread offense. They use the quarterback as a runner. Cal, on the other hand, 38 points a game. More of a pro-style offense. Their quarterback is a true drop-back-style quarterback.
We watched Washington scare USC. Now, are the Trojans vulnerable out West?
Well, maybe by USC's standards, they are vulnerable. But everyone knows, to win the Pac-10, you're going to have to beat the Trojans. Both these teams get a chance to go do it later in November. I think the winner of this game tonight, Brent, has a legitimate shot to do it because they're going to leave here with a lot of confidence and a lot of momentum.
Bob, you would agree with me. Two of the best running backs in the country. Jonathan Stewart of the Ducks tonight. He's matched against number 10, Marshawn Lynch of the Golden Bears. Which one of these great backs tonight will be invincible? Welcome, everybody, to Berkeley, California. Coach Jeff Tedford leads the Bears onto the field. And for the first time, they're wearing these yellow jerseys. You can decide at home if you like them. They're taking a page out of the Ducks' book. And the head coach, Jeff Tedford, who for 4 years was an outstanding offensive coordinator under Mike Belloti at Oregon. Well, Belloti and Tedford have squared off three times in the past. Belloti has a 2-1 edge on his former assistant. Three games decided by a total of 12 points. And against Cal overall, Belloti 7-1, good record. Let's check in with Lisa Salters. Lisa?
Well, Brent, I caught up with Cal quarterback Nate Longshore during warm-ups, and I said to him, look, everyone says this is going to be a high-scoring affair. What kind of game are you expecting? And he said one word, defense. And I kind of looked at him funny, and I said, are you sure with all of this offense on the field tonight? And he said, I'm telling you, one of these teams, somebody's going to come up big on the defense. And he said, you know what? When it happens, you're going to think to yourself, Nate was right. Brent?
We will wait and hold judgment on that, Lisa. Mike Belloti. Gary Kroton, of course,
his offensive coordinator now, the one-time head coach of BYU, and he brought the wide-open spread. Mike won the toss, and he elected to receive. So he wants to go on the attack against his one-time assistant, Jeff Tedford. Terrific crowd on hand. It's just about 15 minutes after 5 o'clock here on the West Coast.
Jonathan Stewart led the country in kickoff returns last year as a freshman.
Coming out from the one is Johnson. Short at the 20-yard line, down at about the 18-yard line. So Dixon will come out, and there is a big three as far as impact players are concerned. Dixon, the quarterback, Jonathan Stewart and Jason Williams. They're good too, Coach.
And Brent, you're going to see the true spread offense. Dennis Dixon, the fastest quarterback in the history of Oregon football. Look for him to run the football tonight out of this spread set.
There is the formation you'll be looking at with Dixon up, squaring it with Enoka Lucas, his outstanding center, switches the running back over to his right side. Offensive line holds, and it's intercepted. The first play of the game picked off by Brandon Hampton, the junior from Los Angeles. And the Bears have a first and goal to begin the evening.
Brandon Hampton, the 5'10", 180-pound junior. Dennis Dixon gets a little bit of pressure and flat just throws it to Brandon Hampton.
Marshawn Lynch, the ace running back, gets the first call, bounces. Well, you take a look at their three of a kind stars.
Let's first of all, let's give Nate Longshore credit. He said defense was going to decide this game, Brent, and they got the big turnover. But he's been on fire since the Tennessee game, which was the first game of the year. He's completing 70% of his passes since that time. And Marshawn Lynch and DeSean Jackson, maybe the two most dynamic players in the entire Pac-10.
Going to throw for it. Incomplete. And a flag comes late.
And Brent, the interference is going to be on number 6, Walter Thurman.
Pass interference, defense. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 2-yard line, first down.
I think you're going to see it right here, just bump and run coverage. Grab them a little bit right there with that left hand.
Fullback offset to the right. They send power in that direction. And Lynch is stoned in the hole. Nothing doing. It'll be second down and goal.
And they talk about J.D. Nelson, the heart and soul of this defense, Brent. And that was a big lick. Marshawn Lynch at about 230 pounds, the tailback.
He has it now for second and goal. Bootleg. Can he get there? He throws for it high. Caught back out of the end zone. Back judge right there. Incomplete.
And you see the difference in these two quarterbacks, Brent. You're right. Nate Longshore looked like he had a chance to run to it for it. And the fullback, Byron Storer, actually knocked out of bounds, it looks like, by his own guy right there. Yeah, excellent call. That foot was on the line, don't you think?
Absolutely. It's third and goal as Oregon making a goal line stand. Wide open. Touchdown, California. Goes to the tight end, Craig Stevens. A very big part of the Cal game plan here tonight. Extra point is perfect. Johnson from, this is Stewart. Let me check that. They switch spots this time. And Stewart out of bounds at the 25.
Brent, you said it. It all started with Brandon Hampton on the interception, the first offensive play of the game. That sets up tremendous field position. I want you to watch this play. The tight end, Craig Stevens, right here, 82, is going to delay and hide Oregon in man-to-man coverage, turns him loose. That's a well-designed offensive play against man-to-man coverage.
Jason Williams, the Ducks' rangy, talented receiver, is off to the right of the formation. Four wide, option look. Dixon keeps it and steps his way to the 34-yard line. Now, this offensive line, their average size, 6'5", 317, one of the best out west, only one sack they've surrendered all season. Lucas could make the all Pac-10 team. as the center this year. He's the ringleader. Second down and two for the Ducks. Pounding Stewart right straight ahead toward that yellow line in the first down. Mebane, Desmond Bishop, the linebacker, their number one tackler, and Damian Hughes, number 13. He's going to spend a lot of time tonight trying to defend number four, Jason Williams. And we have an injured Oregon player down on the field, and I believe that could be the center, Lucas.
Option style team like Oregon. So this is a critical injury here early in the football game. Number 51, Jeff Kendall, you see loosening up on the sideline. You mentioned this Oregon offensive line. Three of these players, including Anoka Lucas from Hawaii, three of these offensive linemen on Oregon's team. You see his leg twisted back over top of him.
Another first down at midfield, and it goes to Brian Paysinger, the junior from Long Beach, California. Takes a break on this play. Three wide. Dante Rosario makes it strong to the left on the formation. Deflected and down there. So Dante was the intended receiver.
It's interesting, Brent, this Oregon offense comes in the number one ranked rushing offense in the Pac-10. They've not led the Pac-10 since 1955 in rush offense. So you see the ability of this spread offense to run the football.
Jonathan Stewart, the running back, goes over to Dixon's right. And that's Williams, number four. The big three all lined up back there. And a whistle flag comes down.
Prior to the snap, full start. Offense number 61. 5-yard penalty remains. Second down.
Good news as Lucas, number 55, returns. And Kendall comes out. So a welcome sight for the Ducks.
And Oregon, a big screen team, Brent. They probably threw 12 screens last week against Arizona State, particularly the wide receivers.
Have the field spread. Got time. Left side wide open. And with his first catch, Jordan Kent, the son of the Ducks basketball coach.
And how about Jordan Kent? In high school, won the 100, the 200, the 400, and the long jump state championships in Oregon. And he plays basketball. That's a pretty good combination, isn't it?
There's coach.
Trying to get those girls to sit down right there.
So he can see us.
Yeah.
First down now, Dixon. Just starting to warm up. And chasing him is Damian Hughes. Pump fake, Dixon's going to take off for the first down.
Something else interesting about Jordan Kent, believe it or not, he never played football, organized football, on any level before last season. Now that's absolutely amazing. His coaches says he had no idea how to even use the equipment, how to put on the chin strap, how to put on the pads, and now he's saying that because he's getting a lot of attention from NFL scouts, that if he continues to do well, he may not play basketball or run track at Oregon this season. Right?
And Stewart is hit by Mebane on that play. One thing is becoming very evident as far as the California coaching staff is concerned. Bob Gregory, the defensive coordinator of the Bears, is shadowing Williams with Damian Hughes. Damian is their fine corner, number 13, with five interceptions. He's over now on the right side defensively, matched against number four. Dixon doesn't even look in that direction, comes back to Kent. To the 11-yard line.
And you know it's a homecoming for Dennis Dixon as well. Today's Cal's homecoming game with this Oregon quarterback from right down the road in San Leandro, Brent, only 10 minutes from this Berkeley campus.
Now Hughes comes over to the left side of the defense to take Williams. They're trying to shut him down, and the Ducks are picking him apart with their other receivers. They bunch, throw the screen over there to the running back. And Jonathan Stewart, who was behind the receivers.
Dead ball. Personal foul, defense number 10. Penalty will be enforced half the distance from the end of the play. Automatic first down.
That's Bishop. Dixon on a play fake and a dash for it. Pump fake, Bears are there, won't score. Looks at him, bump and run inside the 5-yard line. the running back is stopped as Bishop had come back into the lineup after being on the sideline for a play. We asked coach about it. He said, we rarely do it, but here they are, third down and goal, Johnson and Stewart. Dixon to throw, incomplete. He doesn't hesitate. Field goal unit trots onto the field. Get on the board here.
Good mind, Brent. This Oregon football team faked a field goal against Fresno to win the football game. When you play a Mike Belloti team, always expect the unexpected in the kicking game.
Now, Paul Martinez is an outstanding kicker, Bobby. 7 of 9. He's hit all 20 of his extra point attempts. California tried to recruit him, and he opted to go up to Eugene and Oregon. With Brady Leaf the holder, the 22-yard field goal puts the Ducks on the board. Well, for years, you didn't think of California Golden Bears as a football school. Then Jeff Tedford moved down here from Eugene. They've always had an abundance of world-class athletes in this part of Northern California. He was able to turn the corner, recruit some of the best in this area, a promise of upgraded facilities, which are going to begin right at the end of this season, and the show is on the road. Now, Oregon's problem with the kickoff snap. Evanson will see what he can do here. Fielded at the 2 by Marcus O'Keefe, one of the tailbacks, looking for a corner, and he is out to the 26-yard line. George Steinbrenner tonight, after his $200 million payroll, spit the bit against the Tigers. Longshore, flanker screen, Marshawn Lynch, the running back, who's over there as the receiver. He's an outstanding receiver. World-class speed. Lavelle Hawkins, Robert Jordan, and DeSean Jackson. He has run a 4.29. USC wanted to keep him right there in Southern California. He's one who got away from Pete Carroll. Craig Stevens, of course, the tight end, has the touchdown catch tonight for the Bears, who now have a first and 10 at the 45. Now his running ability between the tackles. Brent Haberle, a linebacker, broke an arm. So Blair Phillips, his hands are full. And J.D. Nelson, who is Darren Nelson's son, as we mentioned earlier in a broadcast, they have got to provide the leadership here tonight as the Bears are moving right back down the field. Second down. And there's Robert Jordan's first reception of the night. Had the first down that time. The Bears are forced to punt. Andrew Larson averaging 43.8 yards a punt, 8 of his 19 inside the 20.
Yeah, no question, DeSean had a chance right there, Brent, for the first down.
The three protectors that several schools are now showing up with. Jeremiah Johnson lets it go on into the end zone. It'll come out on the 20-yard line.
Holding, receiving team number 99. The foul occurred beyond the line of scrimmage and will be enforced as a post-scrimmage kick foul half the distance from the 20-yard line. First down.
A landmark. Tight Wad Hill. The free seats looking down on our sellout crowd at Memorial Stadium. 7-3, their Bears lead the Oregon Ducks. The Ducks have the football coming out from the 10-yard line. Stewart looking for a corner. Out of bounds, just short of the first down, picking up 9+. Hicks able to ram him out of bounds. Tightens up on Jason Williams. So there are the Division 1A running backs in pretty good group there, Coach.
How about three starts, over 140 yards in all three starts. Didn't play against Stanford because of an ankle. Pretty good cast of characters right there, those other three guys, too.
This is second down and 9. Obviously, he got a first down on the on that earlier run. I thought he was just shy of it, so let me correct myself. And now it is second down and 9. And look at that, Dixon create another first down, diving for it. Here's the big difference between these two teams, Coach.
No question, Brent. I mean, this is the true spread offense quarterback. One thing I would say to Dennis Dixon, tuck that football away a little bit. Hold it a little more high and tight. But he is a dynamic player as we look at Mike Belloti.
Using his big back, picks up one block, but nothing doing. penalty flag, you could see movement.
Prior to the snap, false start. Offense number 77. 5-yard penalty remains, second down.
Right guard Massoon. On second and 19. Can't find an open receiver, and he is dumped on the 21-yard line. Desmond Bishop, the hard-hitting linebacker.
And that is a great open field tackle. We ISO right here on Desmond Bishop, the linebacker. Just throws his body at Dennis Dixon and gets him on the ground. Not exactly a form tackle, Brent, but a great effort. You see that football jarred out right there.
Five receivers spread across. Penalty flag, holding is called.
Holding. Offense number 75. That penalty will be declined. Fourth down.
The hold is going to be right at the top here. Jeff Swartz, 75, has Nia Tafoa locked up.
Aaron Knowles, number 98, back to punt. The three protectors. DeSean is hit just as he catches it. 3, Cal with the lead. Down to 2 minutes left, and the Bears with the ball coming out for the 45. Nate Longshore. Sideline drop. So Longshore and the Bears' highly touted passing game hasn't got it going yet. And they still have it.
By Dexter Manley. I think people around the country will recognize that name. His father played in the NFL. You look at Dexter Manley, he had 3 sacks, Brent, in the second quarter against Arizona State last week.
His daddy was a sackmaster with the Washington Redskins. Son came out of junior college. Signed on at Eugene. Third down and 10 for the Bears. Back in the gun.
Prior to the snap, full start. Offense, number 53. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Third and 15. Longshore gets time, fires, first down.
And Lavelle Hawkins, you see 2 deep coverage. Look at the middle of that football field, wide open as they split those 2 safeties and went right down the middle. Brent, look at the grass, or in this case, artificial surface, wide open, and a huge third down conversion right there.
Deep middle, wide open, touchdown, DeSean Jackson.
And that's what 4-2-9-40 looks like against man-to-man coverage. He just beat Jairus Byrd, the corner.
Tom Schneider, been perfect this year. Tacks on another one.
Jairus Byrd playing way off coverage, gets his hips turned to the sidelines, and then DeSean Jackson just beats him back inside to the post.
They have not put the extra point up on the board. The kick was good.
5-yard running into the kicker on the defense. That penalty is declined. The try is good.
Wow.
Coming out, Stewart. Gamble that failed. And the Bears have won 4 in a row after being throttled in Knoxville by Tennessee. Lead at 14-3 as they climb their way back up the polls and in the Pac-10 race. Oregon, meanwhile, undefeated and trying to rally. And the big fella finally gets into the attack. Jason Williams, first catch of the night. And you can see how talented he is.
And there's some big receivers in this country, but this guy's the biggest. He's 6'5", 245, 177 yards receiving against Oklahoma.
There you see number 13, who's been shadowing him all night. Just gave up the first play. Option look. Dixon keeps it all the way to the 30-yard line. Second and 8. Bear defenders urging the crowd into it again.
And Zach Follett, a linebacker, miscommunication right there when the offensive line, Jeff Swartz, the right offensive tackle, didn't come off.
a whistle was inadvertently blown because the 25-second clock was inadvertently started with less than 25 seconds on the game clock.
How about the three O's right there on Dennis Dixon? One on the helmet, two under each eye.
Will the clock operator please reset the game clock to 18 seconds, which was the time when the ready for play was given.
And Zach back in the field says, I'm coming again. And 75, Jeff Schwartz says, you're not getting there this time, buddy. Running play to Jonathan Stewart's the running back. Dixon's going to throw for it in. Almost intercepted by Bishop. Did he get it? Yes, he did.
Cal with their second interception of the night. You're going to see Dante Rosario, the tight end, come across. A little holding there by Bishop, tugging on his back. But a great effort, actually, by Dante Bishop. It was Worrell Williams tugging on him a little bit.
When he holds the ball up, I thought it had bounced on the ground looking at it from behind him. But what a great catch, and he held it up with one hand to show him he had it all the way. What a fine-looking linebacker he is. And now the Bears and Longshore go back to work. Another completion. Marshawn carrying it. Cut off. Let's go up close and personal.
Marshawn Lynch, running back, California, family first.
You know, Marshawn is family first. There's no question about it that that's his main focus.
Talk to my mom every day. Every day. I can't get her off my phone, matter of fact. She was always there when I needed her. Came through in the clutch when times was rough, you know, so that's my mama.
And he does not mind being called a mama's boy, but there's a great story involving mom when she comes to these games. We're going to hear from Lisa here in a moment on this one. Short of the first down, still throwing for
it. Well, I saw his mom. She actually is in her seat right now, but Brent, usually she paces up and down the sidelines. I talked to her about it, and she says it's just nerves, but for right now I'm going to try to sit for as long as I can, but rest assured I will be up and pacing the sidelines at some point during the game. As you said, Brent, Marshawn Lynch is a self-described mama's boy. He has the words mama's boy tattooed on his back, and when I asked him, aren't you worried that people are going to think you're soft? He said, they can think whatever they think. I am a mama's boy. That's just the way it is.
Third down and short now. Mama's boys in that eye, and they give it to the fullback, the lead blocker, and they didn't surprise the Ducks. Well, there's DeLisa Lynch now watching, and the Bears are going to go for it. Her son will be in that eye behind the fullback. It is fourth and about a half yard. Here he comes. He got that first down. It'll be first down and goal for the Bears. Yeah, baby.
Yeah. This is a great shot from right on top. I mean, he just ran over top.
A couple of picks. Going to throw. Deflected, intercepted. Picked off in the end zone. Coming out on the 20-yard line. Jairus Byrd, the freshman from Clayton, Missouri.
Third tight end David Gray is going to come across on the crossing route. And the ball is batted by number 33, Blair Phillips. And Brent, keep in mind, that was first down and 10 as Jairus Byrd comes up with the interception for Oregon.
Now we'll see if Dixon and the Ducks can take advantage of the break. Dropped. Second and 10, here comes the blitz. And that inside shovel pass off to Stewart, 14-3. Cal just turned it over. Going in for a possible touchdown, ball was loose. Ball on the ground. Bears say they've recovered it, which would be the third turnover. Let's see. They'll unpile everybody. There it is.
Just going to go with number 43. But a huge turnover on third and five. He never had the handoff from the quarterback right there. And that's option football right there, because Jonathan Stewart wasn't sure he was going to get the football. And another huge turnover.
First down and 10 for the Bears. Here comes Lynch, big hole left side, explodes. Lynch Lynch going to the goal line, down to the 1 yard line.
Somersault. It'll be all right.
But we look at Mama's boy right here. The thing he can do, Brent, he can power you. And how about that stiff arm to the face right there? That is some strength. He put it on Patrick Chung, number 15.
And Justin Forsett, smaller but a talented backup, is the running back. This time they stay on the ground over the top, and the Ducks throwing back.
I was distracted by that forearm to the face he put on Chung. Really hard to see right there, Brent.
And the quarterback keeps it. Nate Longshore came back this year, had the nightmare in Tennessee. He has a wonderful attitude, has rebounded well, has them ahead now. Snyder's extra point makes it 21-3. He suffered a tragedy in the spring when his father passed away at a very young age. We'll tell you that story. Is Jeremiah Johnson on a cutback to the right, spins, and he's down. 21-3. Turnovers, turnovers, turnovers. Oregon, 3 turnovers and 4 penalties. And we still got 9:44 left in the first half. Running play. Big Stewart to the 29-yard line. And, Bob, let's check out those miscues.
Brent, you said it. Particularly on the road, it's difficult to survive 3 turnovers early in this football game. Keep in mind, Oregon, 41 players on their football team from the state of California. This is a huge game as you look at the concern right there on Mike Belloti's face.
On 2nd and 7, here's Williams. Short of the first down, they gang up on him. They'll try to run for it, and the Bears jumped it. Knowles hits it at the 25-yard line. Jackson runs up, trying to deke him. Did. Got the great speed. Out of bounds.
Cal beat USC to recruit him. Long Beach Poly with more NFL players than any other high school in the country.
He had reason to woof. A young fellow there on the sideline pushed him down. We'll take another look at that.
Well, there are some houses with a beautiful view. Strawberry Canyon looking down on this 70,000 crowd Memorial Stadium. This is old school, folks, and due to be remodeled starting at the end of the season. Forsett, the running back. Remember, Marshawn Lynch was injured on the play that set up their touchdown.
Let's go back to the sideline and let's take a look at Blair Phillips, the Mike linebacker over here on the sideline, number 33. Just a gentle little how do you do. And now watch. And he's not afraid of them big linebackers now, is he, Coach? Huh?
No harm, no foul, though, right? Blair Phillips just protecting himself a little bit there on the side.
From the gun, incomplete, trying to put it back in Jackson's hand. Long short, got a through too high.
A whole lot of folks are starting to use now.
He ain't coming.
At the hang time, fair catch at about the 21-yard line. Dixon gets plenty of time. 2nd and 10. Show blitz, here they come. Blitz the run, and Stewart's thrown back.
Both inside linebackers come through the guard center gaps, and Zach Follett again in the backfield for another big play.
Deflected, incomplete.
And a great look right here from Skycam. That ball was batted, as you mentioned. And how about this Cal defense, Brent?
Cal should have wonderful field position. And there was a bear on top of Knowles. Here's Jackson dancing at the 35, trying to get a block on that side. Cuts back. Looking for daylight. Got one man to beat. He explodes, end zone ahead. Touchdown, Bears. Now a late penalty flag. Jackson was already at the 10-yard line when it was thrown behind him.
There is no foul on the play.
But is this not the next Reggie Bush in this conference? You don't coach this, Brent. He takes it, reverses his field, and it gets a great block right there. And now the 4-2-9 kicks in.
No negatives involved whatsoever. Love it up here in Cal. And it's 28-3.
Right here, Dante Rosario, if we let this run, right there. Did you see it? He jumped in the air and kicked the Cal player, and they see the flag come out. How can you put that flag back in your pocket?
He had a perfect view of it, and he wanted Rosario tossed out of the game. It wasn't picked the flag up, and now Johnson returns
it. Has a legitimate point. I want you to watch right there. Right there. He clearly jumped in the air and kicked that Cal player, and the flag comes
watch
out.
Watch this.
That's exactly what he did.
Offside, kicking team. Receiving team has elected to have the 5-yard penalty enforced from the end of their run. First down.
Option. Pitch to Stewart, who dives ahead to the 36. Now, Marshawn Lynch was shaken up. First and 10.
Well, Brent, as you recall, a couple of minutes ago, Marshawn Lynch, that play on the 1-yard line, he says that the player fell on his leg. At first, the trainers were working on his right ankle, but he says it's an entire right leg. And I know that because he walked over to the fan section and started hugging and talking to his family members. He said he just wanted to consult them about whether he should go back into the game or not. I said, you guys are up pretty big. He goes, not big enough. I want to get back in there. But obviously, he's in a lot of pain.
And I mean, Zach Follett right now, the defensive player of the game so far, that is a lick right there.
Option look. Pitch dives for the first down.
For our Aflac trivia question, how many first-round NFL quarterbacks has California head coach Jeff Tedford coached?
The only hint I'll give you is remember he was at Fresno State for a while before he went to Oregon and then came down to California. Just go ahead and see if you can jot down the name. He returned after missing a couple of plays. Touchdown would be huge for Oregon late here in the half. Dancing to the left. He'll keep it. Now he's got the first down.
No question the ability of Dennis Dixon right here. Stays in bounds, gets what he can get, and then get out of bounds.
Jeremiah Johnson is the running back. He throws the block. The throwback, Williams drops it. Loading at Arizona State last week. They've come up limping here in Berkeley so far, haven't they? But plenty of time. 2:41 now. Dixon slides down short of the first down. And the most dangerous weapon they've had in three wide receivers for Dixon. Third down and 7. Johnson now gives him a fourth out to the right. Sacked.
Can you go no backs, empty, Brent? You have 5 blockers. That time, Bob Gregory and Cal brings 6 rushers.
A long field goal attempt coming up here. Then Matt Evanson, and it's a fake. The throw, got it. First and goal, and there you are, Bob Davey. You called it as Rosario makes the catch. Anytime you're dealing with Belloti, you've got to watch the fake kicks.
And Brent, they hit him on the sidelines. Dante Rosario at 250 pounds. He's over there on the sidelines. Nobody from Cal saw him.
And Brady Leaf, the holder, comes up throwing.
That was a well-executed play. You're going to see him right here at the bottom of the screen. And Cal late reacting. Huge play by Mike Belloti and that coaching staff. That was a heck of a fake right
Ball
there.
Ball spotted right inside the 1-yard line. Stewart, the big back, is back in right next to Dixon. Stewart and loses yardage.
That's my one problem with the spread.
California will call a timeout and, with 1:02 to go. How many first-round NFL quarterbacks has he coached? Did you write down 6 names? If you did, you're right. Remember Trent Dilfer when he was an assistant down there? How about Akili Smith when he went to Oregon? Then Carr came out, remember, and he had spent some time with him when he was on the Fresno staff. And then following that, Joey Harrington, Kyle Bowler, and, of course, Rodgers is now with the Green Bay Packers, all six drafted in the first round.
At any rate, we got second and goal. It's Saturday Night Football here, and Stewart pounds to the end zone for the touchdown. Jonathan Stewart's fifth touchdown of the season. The Pac-10's leading rusher.
And the thing you love, Brent, they put the quarterback under the center. They put a lead blocker in there. They went to the I formation and pounded it.
This is a trademark, too, on the extra point. They'll swing the gate over. And believe me, they've got plays out of that also. But here, you would think that the percentage. And Evanson. He tacks on the extra point. O'Keefe and Hughes are back to return and on the ground. Takes a high hop. One of the wedgemen returns to the 34-yard line. After the spring game, his father, Todd, passed away in tragic circumstances. Nate told me yesterday he was gardening, took an ugly fall, a nasty elbow injury, and a blood clot set in, and he died at a very young age. And his mother and daughter here, and I asked Nate, I said, how you holding up? And he said, you know, it's been tough, but that's just part of life, and you've got to go on. I know that Pops would want me to keep on playing and came back to school. He's a Mormon youngster, has not gone on mission. He'll do that after he finishes up here. 6 of 13 tonight, pair of touchdown passes. So Nate Longshore, and he's a big rascal now, 6'5", 280, 233. And he looks like he's got a solid future. He's just a wonderful personality. And there's the backup running back, Forsett. Where are they going to let time run out?
The Cal defense has been impressive. And anytime you're on the road, as Oregon's the visitor, and you turn the ball over, Brent, on the first play of the game, it's hard to recover from that. But this Cal defense, two interceptions and a fumble recovery. But I go back to the first offensive play of the game, and Oregon threw that interception. Tough to dig out of that hole because you lose just so much confidence on the road.
But Oregon has enough firepower to climb back in?
No question. No question. And the fake field goal at the end of the first half was huge for Oregon.
Yeah, Brady Leaf, the holder and the backup quarterback, he rose up and threw a strike to Rosario, and that set up their touchdown. We've got a sellout crowd, folks. First time out of the box, and they're going to bring it out with O'Keefe. And O'Keefe crosses the 20 and down at about the 23-yard line.
The biggest thing to me, we've talked about, obviously, the turnovers and then the points off of turnovers right there. Yardage-wise, no question Oregon can move the football out, gain Cal 183 to 161. But the turnovers, particularly on the road, killed Oregon.
The biggest negative for the Bears is the fact that Marshawn Lynch went to the locker room early, and we see that Justin Forsett is opening at running back for the Bears. So he's behind Nate Longshore. DeSean Jackson, their speedy wide receiver, already has returned a punt for a touchdown tonight. Timed in 4-2-9. Longshore going to put it up to start the second half. Oh. Caught beautifully by number one, DeSean Jackson. The speed kills, folks, over and over again.
And you see the red shirt freshman corner, Walter Thurman, one-on-one, and Nate Longshore, Brent, checked to that play immediately when he saw one-on-one coverage. And what a catch. This is a dynamic young football player.
41 yards. He has 77 receiving and the long punt return for set to the 33-yard line. And when you take a look at this pass chart, he sprays it all over the field.
Well, the thing that jumps out is how well he throws the deep ball. Look at those deep zones. He hasn't thrown an incompletion down the field tonight.
They are making a statement, and I dare say it's being heard loud and clear down in Southern California. When the Bears come a-calling, that's going to be some football game down at the Coliseum between USC and the Bears. Second down and one. Forsett has jumped that time beautifully.
left unsaid by the Bears coaching staff and players. They were rather quiet around us about it. But it is clear that they were embarrassed by Tennessee, and they couldn't wait to go back under the bright lights. Doing it again, out of bounds. Incomplete.
Morgan has blocked two kicks on the season, Brent.
They were coming after that one. Perfect. Got it. California. Northern California. And if you come to this state, you got to talk about the fault lines. And the Hayward Fault runs right underneath Bob David. And then it crosses under Lisa Salter. I'm safe. I'm on the other side. But, folks, when you see this, you just kind of want to turn away. Look at how it's separated and is being held together there.
You want to switch that?
No, you stay right there. You got me covered. Massive remodeling job will begin right at the end of this season. Out behind us where the television trucks are parked. They will have a roof over a brand new, beautiful weight room, offices, meeting rooms, and an Olympic workout facility. Great all-around athletics here in California. Johnson, the return man. And he makes his way just short of the 30-yard line.
And I asked Oregon head coach Mike Belloti, what went right on that late touchdown drive to end the half that maybe wasn't going on earlier in the half? And he said we had a better rhythm, better tempo, but of course we didn't make any mistakes. We didn't turn the ball over. Bottom line, he said, I told my guys at halftime, stop being so user-friendly. We got to stop giving them the ball. Update on Marshawn Lynch. Cal officials have told me that he is going to play. He was out here a little bit earlier warming up. He's going to try to give it a go. Right.
All right, Lisa, thank you. Dixon and the Ducks attempting to rally. Kent picks up a first down, and he's out to the 45-yard line with Desmond Bishop, very active linebacker. They have been shadowing Jason Williams with Damian Hughes, the corner, throughout the evening. Now they throw in underneath to Kent again to midfield, and we've got an update coming up.
Attention performance, go to ESPN.com.
All right, Matt, I've got a vote for you, my friend. The blocked field goal by Clemson against Wake Forest in the fourth quarter. I think Clemson put 24 up on the board, and they were in danger of losing that game. If you haven't seen it, folks, switch over to SportsCenter or ESPN to catch it. Catch it on your local news. It's a heck of a play.
I've got one, too. The fourth down pass interference in overtime on Minnesota that gave Penn State the first down and ultimately won the football game for the Nittany Lions.
Third and six. Joe Pa finally got one to fall his way. He didn't have to chase down that referee. Shuttle pass inside. Here comes Stewart trying to get the first down. Muscles for it. He's a good-looking back. Jonathan Stewart. How big do you say he is, Bob?
234 pounds, and that was a great effort because he was actually hit in the backfield, if you look initially. Right there, he runs through the tackle of number 10, Desmond Bishop. Benches 410 pounds. Great calves and lower body. How about those calves?
Looks like a linebacker, but anyway, he's built there.
And you see the special tape on the right ankle. Has had an ankle injury all year. Wears a special shoe called the Michael Vick shoe from Nike that only Michael Vick wears because of the ankle problem.
Stewart missed that block and that Vick and Dixon has to slide downfield. Back in the gun. Pocket holds, goes down sideline, incomplete, and he wanted Williams, and you could see the coverage by Damian
Some
Hughes.
Some people say Damian Hughes, the number one corner in the country. Great confidence right there. You say the big receiver, Jason Williams, pushing on a little bit. But anytime you have a lockdown corner and you can take the other team's leading receiver out of the game, that's a huge advantage.
Yeah, that was part of Coach Gregory's scheme all week long. Williams with two catches for 18 yards, and there is Stewart, and a great tackle by Hughes.
And Brent, Jason Williams at 6'5", 240. Watch, he has a chance to make a block out here on the option, and Damian Hughes just whips him.
Fourth down and a six. Aaron Knowles, the punter tonight. From behind him. Fair catch is the signal. They'll let it go on into the end zone. the very well-known Telegraph Avenue here. And folks are talking college football these days around Cal. 72,516 sellout at Memorial Stadium. The Bears lead it 31-10. And here is Nate Longshore completing another pass. Now, Nate Longshore leaves two tickets for Jessica Simpson for every game.
I mean, you know, you start out with one little thing, and then before you know it, it becomes this big ordeal. But, I mean, if it's going to get her to come, I'm all for it. So, I mean, I do leave a couple tickets for her for every game in case she feels like swinging through Strawberry Canyon. If she comes, we'll show her a good time for sure. And, you know, maybe she'll decide she wants to watch a little football.
He promised me he'd leave two at the Coliseum in the USC game.
He's a good-looking guy. He's got no shot. None. She hangs with a completely different crowd.
But by what? Maybe he'll be a first-round draft choice.
I'm telling you, no shot. Is that a great story?
It's wonderful. Well, you know, Jerry Glanville, my old buddy, who's assistant coach with Hawaii, he always left two for Elvis, right?
Well, it's a better idea to leave two for Jessica Simpson than Elvis. I'll give you that.
I'd say. Third down now coming up. Third down and four for Nate Longshore and the Golden Bears. Protected pocket, throws in underneath, needed to get to the 30-yard line for the first down. That's Forsett. Really a solid point here. First down and 10, and incomplete. It'll be second down 10 out here in Berkeley. Second down and 10 now. Dropping it off to Follett. There's another first down. He's got some burst to the 45, and Forsett to the 45-yard line.
Probably start anywhere else in the country.
Marcus O'Keefe has checked in at running back. So it's possible with this lead that Tedford's not going to send Lynch back into the game. Going to go long. Got a man open. Juggle incomplete. Lavelle Hawkins, who had a big day, or I should say, let me check that, Robert Jordan.
You talk about team speed. Again, they find Walter Thurman, the redshirt freshman. Wow. Wow. But the team speed of this Cal football team, Brent, you can't throw it any better than that.
Second and 10. Longshore back in the gun. That's what Coach Dunbar brought from Northwestern, and the flag flies prior to the whistle. Let's talk about Mike Dunbar. He was the offensive coordinator at Northwestern, moved in because Jeff wanted to get a little bit of spread offense. And, of course, the biggest thing, the biggest change, is he put the shotgun in. And Coach Tedford telling us, we're not going to spread the field with four wide receivers. That's not going to happen here. We're still going to play our offense.
And a great point. Mike Dunbar comes from Northwestern, where they are a true spread offense, similar to Oregon. But the only thing that Jeff Tedford took from that package, really, as you mentioned, is the shotgun. And I think that really helps Nate Longshore. And you take a look at Mike Dunbar right here on the right. He put together some prolific offenses at Northwestern.
He sure did. Second down and 15. Draw play. Forsett back on the field. And timeout has been called by the Bears. Third and 7 for Longshore and the gang. Over the middle, picked up another first down, went right back to Craig Stevens, his tight end.
Craig Stevens, the big tight end, a great little head and shoulder move to the outside, and then beat him back inside. Little pump fake by Longshore.
First down and 10. They go with the running play, and we bring in Mr. Herb Street from down there in Gainesville. And Kirk, tell us about what went on today in the SEC. What does it mean that Auburn was upset by Arkansas and Florida got through?
Well, obviously, Auburn losing today was not a fluke. Arkansas put on a clinic, guys, on both sides of the ball in the trenches. Darren McFadden had a good game, and their young freshman quarterback continues to look good. But here in Gainesville, I think Florida made a strong case, beating LSU, beating Alabama, beating Tennessee earlier in the year. They're the number two team in the country right now behind Ohio State.
Second down and 5. Now, you have touted Michigan for the last couple of weeks. Are you suddenly off the Wolverine bandwagon now? Or do I see you're jumping? Did Southern Hospitality do that to you today?
I'm not jumping, Brent, but what I saw today in this atmosphere, I just was really impressed. Not to mention, we kept talking about Florida's schedule. I personally didn't think they could continue to get through some of these teams. The fact that they have beaten now LSU, Alabama, and Tennessee, I think you just have to recognize the competition. I'd have Michigan right behind Florida, but right now Florida, who goes to Auburn next week, I would definitely put in at number two.
So here we've got third and three for the Bears. Longshore got another first down. And that time he did hit Lavelle Hawkins, who had the big game against Oregon State.
And Kirk, you missed it. Big time seafood dinner last night. And Brent picked up the tab. So you missed a heck of a spread out here on the bay. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh.
And how about those
I wish I could have been there.
Oh, I know. We thought of you. But how about the USC Trojans?
That's worth the triple O.
Yeah.
Oh, man. How about USC guys the last 2 weeks really finding a way late in very, very fortunate today against Washington. I thought the officials in the Pac-10 really blew it for Tyrone Willingham, not giving his offense enough time there late to get set up to run a play. That was officiating. They deserve to have that last play.
They're on first down, and Longshore is on the money going right back to Hawkins. Twice in a row he has hit him. And, Kirk, I know you've had a chance to watch our game down there. What's your impression? Are you really surprised about what the Bears have done here? I know, because I watched game day. You were talking about Oregon. You thought they might pull it off here.
Yeah, I thought there'd be more of a shootout. I thought Oregon's offense would be able to score against Cal. Obviously, Cal at night, you knew their fans would be fired up. Oregon's not been able to get on anything in rhythm offensively. But the thing about Cal is they are great on offense, but I think they're showing that they can play some defense tonight. But let's put DeSean Jackson in the Heisman discussion. That guy is a player, and he's as good as there is in college football.
Going for the first down mark that time, Justin Forsett. Bring the replay back here, and Kirk from Gainesville, take it for us.
Well, they've been showing speed, and Coach Davey's been talking about this, being able to bounce the ball to the outside. And even with Marshawn Lynch down, that's the difference this year with Jeff Tedford's team, is the depth that they now have. They can sustain a few injuries, and Forsett, who's really been coming on last year and even into this year, gives them that depth in the backfield and a nice tandem of backs that the Cal Bears have. But there's just too much speed on the field right now for Oregon to deal with.
And Kirk, what impresses me the most, it looks like Cal's going to escape Lee Corso's double whammy. He picked them to win the national championship. They lose to Tennessee. Then I see he picked them tonight. I thought he gave them the kiss of death, and I think that they're going to escape that, I think.
But it's still early now. You know, he'll pick them to win forever. So there's still a chance that the Malokia eye, as he says, could still come back to haunt him.
You know, Kirk, mentioning the Heisman Trophy, there's a young man that I think has been overlooked, and he's really throwing the ball well, and that's Chad Henne up at Ann Arbor. I know we're going to see him next week at Happy Valley.
Yeah.
Well, I really have been impressed with how he's throwing.
You know what, Brent, when you talk to the Michigan people, not only Henne, the way he's throwing the football, but the leadership. And I think that's been the biggest difference this year for Michigan. As a group, there's more continuity. They seem more determined. And I think Mike Hart running and Chad Henne throwing and the leadership, the intangibles, have been key.
And a reach back for the touchdowns, the young man who dropped it. Robert Jordan comes back after dropping a sure touchdown pass.
And again, the speed and quickness in the open field of these Cal skill players. And Brent, this is a totally, totally different team than the nation saw in Knoxville the first game of the year. They put that game behind them.
So it's 38-10, but we've got a flag down. So hang on here just a second. Yeah, there they go again, huh? And take a look here, Coach.
You're going to get a personal foul. One of the Oregon rushers jumps on the back of a Cal offensive lineman. Right there, you are not allowed to use the offensive player as a springboard.
That I mentioned here as we await the kickoff. And there, of course, the Buckeyes, they defended number one. Auburn's going to take the fall. And Kirk is thinking that Florida is going to jump up. What about West Virginia, Kirk? They're just simply not getting any respect. Is it because of the schedule?
Yeah, I think it is. I think people are kind of holding out, waiting to see West Virginia and Louisville. I think Louisville will move up a lot this week in the polls now that they've remained unbeaten, continue to be impressive despite the injuries. But I think West Virginia and Louisville, the jury is still out waiting for that game. I've been really disappointed in USC. I think Cal now is clearly the best team at this point in the Pac-10, and SC needs to continue to develop on offense. They've been very fortunate to escape and stay unbeaten in these first 5 weeks.
Hey, Kirk, you remember that Sports Center spring football special we did in like late May or early June when you picked Notre Dame as the national champion, and I, by the way, picked Florida as the national champion, and everybody kind of rolled their eyes. I just wanted to make sure you had the kind of memory that could remember that.
Yeah, we're all keeping score. Okay. We're all keeping track. All right, and you know what? You're doing a great job, because I don't know if many people thought they could get through that schedule, but you did.
I didn't.
I can't remember what I said yesterday. These guys are remembering months ago of what they're picking. Yeah. This is unbelievable, folks. How about the Heisman race now? Still Troy Smith, Kirk, clearly number one.
I think it's still Troy Smith, but there's so much football to be played. I think there are guys that, even like DeSean Jackson, I think he deserves a lot of recognition. Calvin Johnson, another big game for Georgia Tech today. Adrian Peterson continues to impress, even though OU lost to Texas. So, and I think next week when we go to Happy Valley, Mike Hart is a guy who people are talking about. And down here, Chris Leak of the Florida Gators.
And we got a first and 10 now. Indeed it is. Dixon. And that time he hits Williams, going out of bounds on that far side. But pulls out. Deflected, incomplete. And there was that matchup. I'm telling you, 13 is on him like a glove. Here they are, 6'5 versus 5'11. But Hughes, the little engine who thinks he could, and he's doing a job tonight.
And the big play on third down when Oregon ran the option, Damian Hughes' run support was a key play, not only pass defense.
48 points on the board, 1:47 to go here in the third.
It's Berkeley crowds, impressive now.
They've been in it, haven't they, Bob?
They're in it.
Got it back into the hands of Williams that time.
Well, they're undefeated since Urban Meyer's taken over down at the Swamp. And this is one of the loudest stadiums, as you guys know, in all of college football. They're so supportive. And I think they had a lot to do with why LSU turned the ball over so much.
You know, Kirk, as we think about the problems that Oregon is having here, and you go back to your playing days and Bob to his coaching days, what is it that teams have two personalities? They come on the road in a game like this, and they just don't play like they have up in Eugene. What do you think affects them the most?
I think maturity. I think we've seen on our broadcast with Ohio State the difference in having an experienced quarterback when you go on the road and a guy who really knows how to handle himself. And I think what's hurting Oregon is their only go-to guy right now is Jason Williams. They don't have anybody else to make plays on the other side.
Here's Kent. 45, first down, and he's across midfield with a nice burst. Well, I told you this was old school, Bob. let's take you down inside the Ducks locker room. This is the visitor's locker room, folks. This is not like the one up in Eugene. This is it. Now when they leave, they go downstairs, back upstairs, and then on out a tunnel. I mean, it is some interest we want to show you here. First down and 10 for Dixon and the Ducks. Ball at the 45-yard line. Option, keeping it to the 41-yard line. So now here it is, Bob. Yeah. Look at the big fellas. He'll be real careful here now.
You talk about earthquakes. One of those big guys slips right there. But I promise you this, it'll be a lot longer walk back up that steps after this game, after the kind of whooping they're taking here tonight. But you try not to let things be distractions on the road. That is one of the worst visiting locker rooms I've seen.
And then you come out this tunnel, and at the end of the tunnel, another set of steps, and then you come up and you take your whooping. And they open a can of whoop, you know what, here. Second down. Drills it. Beautiful throw. And it's to the 29-yard line, and Jonathan Stewart, the running back, slips out. Now, they've held Stewart to 25 yards rushing on 18 carries. He came in, remember, averaging 7.9 yards a carry, but they can't shut him down. This is a fine throw by Dixon.
both these tailbacks so similar, Marshawn Lynch and Jonathan Stewart. Not only power backs that can also break tackles, but excellent receivers as well.
And the final half minute now ticking away. End zone incomplete. Second down and 10. Go deep now. Williams, touchdown. And there is a penalty flag. He may have pushed off. He may have pushed off Hughes. Let's hold on. Yep, that's what Hughes is signaling. I got pushed. And from the naked eye, that's what it looked like as they came across the goal line. What'd you see, Bob?
I saw exactly what you saw. Dennis Dixon, great job of keeping the play alive, but.
Whoa, we didn't exactly see that, right? Damian, we were agreeing with you, but the vote that counts disagreed. Take a look, Coach.
We're going to get a great look at it right here. Keep in mind, Dennis Dixon scrambles. Now it turns into a scramble drill. Wow. Probably a good no call, period.
I agree. 29-yard touchdown pass. Yep. Williams, besides, it makes it closer. And get back to within three scores for our fourth quarter. And, Kirk, it's Pac-10 football. It is amazing how when you come out here, how they throw it around. There's so much speed base. It's a different kind of game out here, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it's two things. I'd love to hear what Coach Davey has to say, but I think it's the quarterback and receivers in the Pac-10. They grow up in obviously in the West Coast. They have a chance to throw the football so much. They're so skilled by the time they get to college. And I also think on the other side, there's so much man-to-man coverage by the defenses, less zone blitz and more man-to-man. And I think the quarterbacks are good enough to pick those man-to-man coverages apart out in the Pac-10 every single week.
And the thing I see, Kirk, is just team speed on defense is not as impressive as it is, for instance, in the Southeastern Conference. I look at right. USC as really the only Southeastern Conference-style defense in this league, and that's why, to me, SC's struggling a little bit on offense, but they are still a dominant defense, in my opinion. But its overall team speed's lacking a little bit on the defensive side of the ball for some reason.
Guys, let's remember now, Jeff Sagarin said the Pac-10, surprisingly, this week, Kirk, he ranked them the number one conference in the country.
Wow.
And judging from what Arkansas did in Auburn, he might have something here now. From the 6-yard line, O'Keefe. And he twists his way out to the 20. I know, Bob, that you kind of looked at me when I said that, but this is pretty impressive. Remember,
USC, what
do you think, Kirk?
I think that I don't care what Jeff Sagarin or any other computer out there says. With all due respect to our Pac-10 viewers, forget about it. The SEC is up here, and everybody else is down here. You know what? They're down here. They're watching Cal take care of business tonight. They're laughing because of what happened in week one. And we all know Cal is a much better team than the way they played in week one. But unfortunately for the Pac-10, that's what the SEC and that's what the nation saw, how they played against Tennessee.
I tell you, Kirk, you just slapped Sagarin. But I agree with you. Just the environment and the defenses week to week in the Southeastern Conference can't compare.
Bob Davey, Kirk Herbstreit, Lisa Salters, and Brent Musburger with you. We start the final 15 minutes, 38-17, fourth quarter.
That there is no ceiling on this program. He has done a remarkable job.
Amazing turnaround. And one of the only other ones that I could think of was Kansas State and Bill Snyder. That one was even tougher because they did not have as much talent in the vicinity is what they had here at Cal. But when you think about what those two schools were not accomplishing until Snyder and Tedford showed up, man. But the Dogs put 33 up on the board. And a lot of folks said they did not have an offense. Third and five, firing, incomplete. Winning seasons 2 in 34 years prior to Bill, with the Bears 3 in 19 years, okay? Now that's how they compared before Bill Snyder and Jeff Tedford took over. Johnson. Down at the 30-yard line. It's a full moon over some of the most beautiful sights in the world.
The best is yet to come and babe, won't it be found? The best is yet to come. Come the day you're mine.
On the other side of the bay, the best
maybe yet to come for these California Golden Bears. First and 10 for the Oregon Ducks, who trail at 38-17. Dixon looking to get downfield. Throws deep to Kent. And it's broken up.
Starting because the starting safety, Deku, is out of the game. And you see the speed of Jordan Kent, but Bernard Hicks in great position right there on the deep ball. Really should have made that interception.
Inside shuttle pass. And did he pick it off? They whistle it down and incomplete.
What's your feeling about Kansas State and California? What Bill Snyder did and now Jeff Tedford here, Kirk?
Well, I think first of all, you have to recognize Bill Snyder had one of the better turnaround stories, I think, maybe ever in college football. You have to put Barry Alvarez up there, too. But what Jeff Tedford has done in this conference, in the Pac-10, being able to turn this program around now, and every single year, they are now considered a Pac-10 contender. I think that has to be recognized. But can he continue for the amount of time that Bill Snyder was able to keep Kansas State competitive is the next question.
Yeah, that's a very, very valid point. Third down and 10. And Dixon dropped by Kent. And he might have been across the scrimmage line. Do you think there is a penalty flag? Maybe there was some roughing back there, too. I don't know. The referee threw a late flag over there. Kirk, I think he's got a couple of things going. Bob, take a look at the first of this replay.
I think you're
going
to get Worrell Williams. Whoa. No question. Ooh. Just climbed and launched at the helmet of the quarterback, Dennis Dixon.
But you probably saw that was ugly. And he comes off to the sideline. Jeff was not happy with his own player. And it gives the Ducks a first down at the 45-yard line. Picked off, intercepted by Hicks, and it'll be California Bear football at the 40-yard line, a team that has self-destructed here tonight in Berkeley.
And Bernard Hicks dropped the previous interception, but this one, Dennis Dixon just gift-wrapped it and threw it right down the middle of the field to him. You take a look at it, Dennis Dixon, a young quarterback, is going to be a good player. But Brent, not in a position when you get far behind where he has to throw it every down. That's not his game.
Yeah, it is. Anytime you get down three touchdowns, I think it's tough for any quarterback. It could be Peyton Manning back there, let alone Dennis Dixon, who's still getting his feel and trying to make some plays. And as we talked about a little earlier, outside of Jason Williams, there just aren't enough playmakers out on the perimeter for this Oregon offense.
Dropped. The Bears drop one. It'll be second and 10. Marshawn Lynch has not returned here in the second half. He was injured in the first, and he put his helmet on over in the sideline. Lisa said he was clear to go back in, and probably it's a Tedford decision, Bob. Would you think with Cal enjoying a very comfortable lead not to go back with his number one running back and to keep Forsett in the game?
I think so. They have a comfortable lead, and there's not a great amount of drop-off with Justin Forsett, who he himself was a 1,000-yard rusher basically last year.
Now second down and 10 for Longshore and the Bears. And Forsett is thrown down at the 42-yard line.
And guys, we talked just a little earlier when I just came on with you, but just watching this game tonight, I'm watching DeSean Jackson all season. And I know you guys reviewed the tapes and watched him. I think because he's out in the Pac-10, I don't know if people really fully nationally appreciate his abilities. I'm just so impressed with his competitive spirit. One of these guys that always wants to ball. He's dangerous on special teams. People nationally need to start to pay attention to number one for the Cal Bears. The guy is the real deal.
Yeah, he's the most exciting player in the Pac-10. I don't think there's any question about that.
Yep.
Forsett banging. To go back.
Talked about brought that in there, brought that style in there. And it's amazing to see that you can run the spread without the athleticism from Nate Longshore. They can still have an effective attack.
Yeah, exactly. You mentioned the long range out here. And Kirk, with a massive remodeling job about to start, and there's so much football talent in this immediate area. I mean, goodness, De La Salle is close by. They've got a crowd of about 5,000 over at a high school game. And there's just a ton of talent in the Bay Area. So once this facility is upgraded, I think it's going to be
I think Tedford's going to be able to keep it going unless the lure of the NFL becomes too great. Now, I ask him about it. I do every time I see him. He's very comfortable living here. A couple of teenage children, his wife, and he remember now, he was once offered the head coaching job of the Chicago Bears. The reason why I think they're going to keep coming after Tedford, his attack works in the NFL, uses a fullback, uses three wide. Yeah, it's a little bit of spread with the shotgun, but it's not extreme. It's not an option attack. And he has proven he can deal with quarterbacks. Right now, let's check in with Matt Weiner and an update, Matt.
I thought Colt McCoy, after the way he played against Ohio State, Brent, he was able to kind of get a second chance. People forget he's a freshman trying to replace Vince Young, and today it was his day and the Texas Longhorns' day.
Forsetter stopped short of the first down.
It's also Mac Brown's day, by the way.
Yeah, indeed. Trying perhaps just to quickly draw them offside, then reset and go for it. And they stumble across for the first down with Justin Forsett. And again, a reminder, stay tuned for your late local. I mean, what a season the Tigers have had. And of course, out here, that's a big story because the A's were awaiting the win. A big cheer went up with this crowd when they were told it was going to be the Tigers and not the Yankees.
All about the turnovers in this football game, Brent. Oregon, to be quite honest, didn't show up and play. They're a much better football team than they have displayed here tonight. And then big play, home run ability of the Cal skill position players. You turn the football over and give this ball to the Cal offense that many times with the weapons they have, they're going to run you out of this stadium.
They'll come with the end around with Robert Jordan. Short of the first down. Well, my spies tell me, Coach Davey, that Kirk Herbstreit has been nibbling pizza down there in Gainesville as we try to talk to him. So it's okay. He's clear now. And Kirk, we're gonna let you go. I know you want to spend a couple days back home, and then we'll meet up in Happy Valley. But in looking ahead now, what do you make of Michigan Penn State next week for us? Absolutely. Looking forward to that, my friend. Game day will be down in Auburn first, and then Kirk will jet up to Happy Valley and join us. Justin Forsett moving the chains again as he has replaced Marshawn Lynch. And we don't want to get anybody in trouble here, okay? I wouldn't think of that. First down and 10. Here's the toss play now. Boy, the young backup looks good. Breaks free. Touchdown, Cal. Some are watching this extra point rather carefully. Right down Broadway.
About the hard hat.
So the hard hat being presented. Marshawn Lynch to Justin Forsett. And Lisa, what's the story behind that?
Well, I went over and asked the guys, what's the hat all about? And they said that Marshawn gave it to him because it means it's time to go to work. And Coach Davey was saying that Marshawn might want to get back in this game because he might lose his job to Forsett. But it's actually Marshawn who decided not to go back into this game. He said that he came out at halftime, looked up at the scoreboard, and said, they don't need me. So it was actually his decision not to return.
All right, Lisa, thanks. And back on the goal line is Johnson. Jeremiah looking for a hole. To the 36 in Memorial Stadium here tonight. Sellout. Dixon going deep to Kent. And he's got it at the 20-yard line. So Jordan Kent coming up big. He's the speedster on the outside. Well, let's first watch young Kent here.
Damian Hughes, the corner, gets a little distracted, loses focus right there, Brent, and let Jordan Kent to the outside.
113-yard night for Kent. 44 yards on that, and the Ducks, a penalty flag comes flying. They throw for a strike and a touchdown, but this one could be coming back. Hang on, it was the referee threw the penalty flag at the 30-yard line.
By the look on Belloti's face. Not quite sure that they ever recovered from that quarterback controversy that beset them just before the season started. Those things can be kind of jarring. And here on the pitch now to Justin Forsett, just short of a first down. He's a junior out of Arlington, Texas. So that tells you something about Tedford's reach in terms of recruiting and bringing players into Berkeley.
You know, we haven't talked much about Jeff Tedford and his staff. Obviously, Jeff Tedford Tedford coached at Oregon as the offensive coordinator, but he has, I think, four full-time coaches on his staff with Oregon background. And, Brent, I think about 15 support staff members from Oregon on his staff.
Let's take a look just exactly what you are talking about here. Let's take a look at the California Ducks, if you will. There's the head coach, the defensive coordinator, wide receivers coach, linebacker. Look at the rest of the fellows. Director of football operations, strength and conditioning, video coordinator, two football managers, recruiting assistant, and Ron Gould, who was a player at Oregon, now the running backs coach. I actually asked Jeff if this has created any tension, because that's a whole lot of folks to be bringing down out of Eugene, and he said no. He said that the wide receivers coach, Farino, his wife was living down here, so he was glad to come down. The rest of those fellows, they were elevated to
exactly. You know, Bob Gregory, for instance, comes here as the defensive coordinator. He was the linebacker coach at Oregon, went to Boise for 1 year. So, yeah, reading inside of that as we look at Bob Gregory, it was promotions for even the guys that were the equipment men. Assistant equipment guy at Oregon has a chance to be the head equipment guy at Cal. But don't underestimate what a big win this is just personally for Jeff Tedford to put this kind of whipping on Oregon.
Fourth down and one. Bears keep the ball, pick up a first and 10, and little Justin Forsett has been a tough hombre and some after the whistle wrestling.
And I'll tell you what, the little running backs in this country.
Unsportsmanlike conduct. Offense number one. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
Some of those youngsters, you know, they slip back on the field. They substitute themselves back in.
Not sure I wouldn't take that tailback out right now, too.
Dead ball. Personal foul. Late hit, number seven of the offense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. Second down.
Lavelle Hawkins.
Obviously, Jeff Tedford doesn't like that.
No, he made his feelings very well known over there on the.
And Mike, he's just numb right now after all that's happened.
Yeah, they had faced each other three times before and decided by a total of 12 points. This will even them up. Belloti will have won twice in Eugene. And now Jeff Tedford twice down here. Here he goes. He explodes.
You talk about running straight downhill north and south untouched. We have to give credit to this Cal offensive line. But I'm going to tell you what, Marshawn Lynch, get healthy over there on the sidelines.
They raise him tough in Texas. And for Forsett, 164 yards, one touchdown. O'Keefe, who's not bad himself, the third running back. Let's check out where Oregon goes. You can see California, they come in for 41 of their players, 21 out of Oregon and over to Hawaii for four. 90 players from 17 different states. And then look at the Bears. 98 from California. They get three out of Hawaii. They go up to Oregon for a pair and up to Washington.
A lot of players from Hawaii in this game. A lot of Polynesian players.
Five game winning streak. Jordan Kent for Oregon. Six catches, 113 yards. And the quarterback for the Cal Bears, Nate Longshore, throwing for three touchdowns tonight. We'll see what Jeff elects to do here on third and six. Let's go down now to Lisa.
Just right here.
Nate, you came over to the sidelines to me twice during the game to say I told you so. Tell the folks at home what you meant.
I did not do that. That's a myth. She's making that up. I didn't say it. All I said was our defense was going to show up to play. That's what I said.
Even the guys up in the booth late in the game said they were surprised by how your defense played tonight against that high-powered Oregon offense. So why were you not surprised?
Going against them every day, we know how good they are. And when they come out to play, I mean, they're the best around. So, you know, my hat's off to the defense. They did an outstanding job.
Now, with Marshawn Lynch on the sidelines with that hurt leg, how easy did Justin Forsett make your job tonight?
He's the man. I mean, we got two running backs outstanding, three running backs outstanding. More so than that, we got an offensive line that dominated tonight. I think they showed that. I was very impressed. We moved the line of scrimmage all night long, and that's all you got to do to be successful.
Now, lastly, It's not official, but I don't think that Jessica Simpson made it tonight. Are you going to be okay?
That's all right. Well, there's more games. There's more games.
All right. Congratulations, Brent.
All right, Lisa. He's a piece of work, folks. Nate Longshore. Let him do a 45-24 victory. The Golden Bears win a big one.